CNN International. This is World News.
Good afternoon from the CNN Center in Atlanta. I'm Jonathan Mann.
And good evening from London. I'm Hilary Bowker. Coming up on this edition of World News, Making Contact. Just minutes from now, the Mars Pathfinder will attempt to land on the red planet.
And practicing contact, Russia's cosmonauts simulate repair work for the crippled Mir space station. Thanks for joining us. This is one of those moments scientists have been waiting for. Like nervous parents, they've been watching the Mars Pathfinder move through millions of kilometers of space headed to the red planet. And right now, the spacecraft should be approaching its final descent. Joining us to explain what to expect is Kurt Grimal, a professor of aerospace engineering at the University of Oklahoma. Professor, thanks so much for being with us. You and your team have prepared some sophisticated animations. Talk us through these last few minutes as Pathfinder makes its way to Mars.
Thank you. It's a pleasure being here. The spacecraft is only 7 to 8 minutes from landing on the surface. The animations were done in order to help NASA and JPL instruct the people around the world about what is actually happening. It's impossible to put a camera up there in space and be able to show it real time. And so the next best thing is to have photorealistic animation done.
Okay, so now this package coming from Earth is whizzing towards Mars. I think we can see it there. What are we watching?
Yes, this is just before the tether gets cut and the rockets on the back shell gets fired to get it out of the way. You'll see those fire there. That's simply to get the parachute out of the way as the airbags have been inflated, moving down to the surface, and it'll begin, it's bouncing along the surface trying to come to a rest.
How high is it bouncing right now?
It can range anywhere from 3 or 4 stories high, maybe up to 6 or 7 stories high. The gravity on Mars is only 1/3 that of Earth. The most important reason why it bounces a lot is that those airbags are like super balls, that they're made out of a very stiff material that is highly inflated, and it'll bounce very high.
What is going to happen now? The thing will come to rest and take us through what they're hoping will happen.
After 5 to 10 minutes, it'll finally come to a rest. It'll take over an hour to deflate and to retract the airbags. As that has been come to a stop, there it shows the airbags deflated. After they're deflated and pulled back in, then it tries to open itself up. And it doesn't matter what side or what pedal it lands on, it'll always ride itself back up. The reason the airbags had to be pulled in is so that when the rover moves off one of the pedals, it will not get tangled up in the airbag.
So is this a sure thing? It looks like they've thought it pretty well through. Are they very confident that this is going to work and everything's going to make this enormous journey without any problems?
They are as confident as you can ever be with a space program. There's always something that could possibly go wrong. They've done extensively testing both on Earth and especially test chambers for bouncing of the airbags and opening up the pedals and having the rover move off.
Now, while we're talking, we're watching this move ahead. We're looking at the rover. Is this going to happen as quickly as all of this? Is this expected the rover to start moving within just the next few minutes?
The rover is the very last thing that will happen on the initial day if everything else goes correct. So it'll take over 12 hours before the rover actually will leave the pedal if it's in a condition to do so.
Right now, the Pathfinder is still on its way. We have seen it land. It looked like it was coming down rather gently, but it's going very fast now, isn't it?
Yes, it is. It's going 7.5 kilometers per second. You can travel a lot of distance in 1 second, 7 kilometers. When it comes through the atmosphere, it'll slow down to 500 meters per second. The parachutes will open, and after that, it'll slow down to maybe 40 or 50 meters per second. When it impacts the surface, it'll be going at about 30 to 40 meters per second, and that's one reason why it bounces so much. It is moving the speed of a car when it hits the surface.
We're going to go now to the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California, and listen in because they're hard at work there and awaiting news of the landing as well. Let's listen in. I'm curious about something. While they're working and waiting, they're now just 3 minutes away from there.
In about 15 seconds, the events will follow will occur in rapid succession under the control of the onboard software. I'll report these events as they are expected to occur.
If you're just joining us, we're now approximately 2 minutes and 20 seconds from the landing that's been scheduled.
As this landing takes place, it's very difficult to get this information back as it's going through the atmosphere. Some of the radio waves may not be in full power and be able to get receptions, but it seems at this point that they are getting information back as it's going through.
It's easy to take all of this for granted. We're so used to seeing pictures from the space shuttle. But really they have very little information.
Slowing down rapidly because of parachute deployment. The heat shield should separate in about 3, 2, 1, 0 seconds.
After the heat shield separates, the parachute is slowing it down. The airbags.
The next event is lander separation. That should occur in about 5 seconds. When that occurs, the lander will descend in about 10 seconds down the bridle. Lander separation should have occurred right about now.
You'll notice they say should a lot. Many of these information is pre-programmed, and they're not exactly sure when it's actually happening.
We should be switching from one antenna to another antenna under a slight software control. This is an antenna that improves our ability to see the signal during this descent phase.
So is any human being now in control of this?
No, it is not.
Is any earthbound computer now telling you what?
No, the best we can do is get information back from the spacecraft, and that in itself is difficult.
This is an autonomous entity that's acting on its own intelligence and all of the machinery they could put inside, but it's far beyond anyone's ability to help or control.
I'm not sure if I'd say intelligence, but it's programmed. It's a computer that has a sequence of events that it's following.
While we're waiting, and while they're waiting, I've got a question for you.
The spacecraft should be approximately a mile above the surface of Mars. There's a lot of uncertainty in the timing from here on out because of the variation in the atmosphere.
The atmosphere, this is my question. Mars, if I've read correctly, has an atmosphere only 1% as dense as Earth's. How does a parachute work when there isn't air or something to slow the craft down?
Very good question. It does not work hardly at all, but it does add some slowing, so they use it. If they would work like a parachute on Earth, they would not need the airbags to bounce along. They could just do a gentle drop.
Okay, let's listen in now. I'm just struck by what we're seeing now. This is a moment that they've been working for years, but it comes down to a bunch of guys, ladies and gentlemen, walking around with their arms folded and their hands in their pockets, waiting for news like expectant fathers, really.
It's a very good analogy. Is you have to receive information, you cannot help it in any way. What's going to happen is going to happen, and all you're doing is finding out if it was successful or not.
Yes.
Correct me if I'm wrong. I am told
that a signal is barely visible.
They are getting a signal back. That is great.
It's a very good sign, everybody.
Signal has been received. It means that the spacecraft is intact. At least it has enough information to be able to send a signal out. It does not mean that everything is operational. That will only tell over the next 12 hours as they start testing each piece of equipment, getting the big antennas out to be able to broadcast pictures.
But what you're seeing now is, as close as we can show you, visual evidence that Pathfinder has landed, and landed in one piece with at least enough of its technology intact to phone home and tell everyone that it is okay.
Yes. Now the real fun begins, where you start doing engineering experiments, science experiments, to find more information about Mars, the planet itself.
Now, there was enormous confidence going into this mission that this was going to work. In the last few days, we saw some very confident scientists saying that they really were feeling very positive. But in terms of engineering and science and the hard work that these people do, how hard is it, has it been, to get something successfully landed on Mars?
It's probably as difficult as any mission has been. The nice thing about this one is that it's a smaller one. It's compact. These people are much closer together. It is like a small company coming out with a new wonderful program. They've all worked very hard. It's a lot of energetic people trying to pull this thing off against a lot of odds. And you get very nice products and success when you have that kind of a group working together.
As it would expect it to do after it rolls to a stop.
What
We are now in a blackout situation where the spacecraft will essentially begin to retract airbags. This process takes a little over an hour. Hopefully, we may see a signal when that finishes up. We will keep our eyes peeled, of course. Seeing a signal from the surface of Mars is actually the hard part.
The signal is extremely weak, and for them to be able to receive a signal is a difficult and wonderful thing to have.
What was the signal that made them so excited? Was it a little beeping noise? Was it a computer entry physically or technologically? Exactly what did they get?
It's almost like the static you would have on the FM radio, and the level of the static will tell them some information. That is about all that they're getting. The static is enough different than the normal static that they can identify that it was a signal made from Mars.
It's an extraordinary thing. Something created on this world has now gone to another world. Let me ask you, we can't get a sense of it watching these gentlemen in their air-conditioned quarters, but what kind of conditions have greeted Pathfinder? Is it cold? Is it hot? Is it dark? Is it bright? Is it sunny? Do we know what the weather is like there?
They landed in the night side. It will dawn in about three more hours. At nighttime, it can get as cold as 100 degrees centigrade below zero. The warmest it'll get is about 40 degrees above zero centigrade. So it's very cold. They have to have special warmers in the rover and in the lander to make sure that the electronics continue working and that the battery power will be conserved.
One of the extraordinary things looking at this is that these experts are really as close as anyone has ever come to Mars. They're doing this extraordinary project. Oh, let's listen to what they're saying. These are the greatest living experts on Mars, one would imagine. How much does anyone really know about that planet?
The duration of this signal should tell us a little bit about what the software thinks the spacecraft is, how the spacecraft is oriented.
20 years ago was the last time we had significant information come from Mars, so it's over 20 years since we have any new information other than what the Hubble telescope has been able to give us. So we only know maybe 2 or 3% of what Mars may have to offer to us over the next 20, 30 years as we send 10 more missions to Mars.
For those who are interested, the spacecraft successfully fired off 41 pyrotechnic devices that all had to work perfectly on the 4th of July.
Telecom reports solid state power amp off.
Those pyrotechnic devices blow bolts so that the airbags can be retracted inward. You can't get up there with a wrench and unscrew things. You have to have small explosions to unlock bolts and to get things to start working.
They noted with glee that this
right
is, of course, the 4th of July.
Communications folks to calculate how long that signal was active. Maybe give us an idea along the what orientation the spacecraft is in. The signals that are possible are either you're on the base pedal, which means that the spacecraft does not have to roll over, or it's on a side, in which case it will right itself automatically.
We have a model. You have kindly brought a model of the landing craft. I don't know if we can get a tighter picture of it, but if we can, why don't we put it there? We go. We're moving in and out of the shot. There we go. Show us what it is that is going to happen. There was some talk about the pedals and about whether they would be able to.
Yes. This is the heat shield that went through the atmosphere and was discarded. This here is what landed on Mars. It does not have the airbags around. Currently, it's sitting on Mars in some configuration with large airbags on the side. Those are now being deflated, and they'll be pulled into the surface. After about 3 hours, these leaves or pedals will open up.
An ingenious thing about them, I'm going to interrupt you, they didn't know which side it was going to land on, and that's part of the design here. Show us.
That's correct. The way this thing was designed is that it could land on any one of the pedals, and it will correct itself with these motors that open up the leaves. They're strong enough that they can turn the whole lander around, and then the other two leaves will open up. There's only one concern that they may have, and I'm sure many of the people watching may also ask, what happens if it lands on its top? How does it open up? This is like trying to balance a pencil on your finger, and it's more than likely going to tip over. If it does not, they can jiggle these leaves to try to jar it off to one side and fall over.
So one of the things they're waiting to find out right now, I guess, is how it's landed on which side.
That's correct.
There was also some talk about the craft itself orienting itself. How does it do that in a strange world? It doesn't know where it's facing. It doesn't know how it's landed. How does it figure out and tell the experts back home where it is?
The best way to orient yourself in space is to be able to know where the sun is. After the airbags have been retracted, the pedals have been opened, this camera device here will start moving around and look for the sun. As soon as it locates the sun, then it knows exactly where it's at, what angle it's at, where the Earth is at, and it can send up their high-gain antenna here to be able to get high-speed transmission back to Earth, and that's when the pictures will actually start being sent.
This relates back to some of the delay that we've been hearing about because, once again, as you've mentioned, it's night on Mars right now.
Yes. When these pedals are open, it'll be around dawn. That's when they'll have the low-gain antenna try to communicate to Earth. After that, then they will use the camera to locate the sun, tell them where to point the high-gain antenna. After they get the high-gain antenna working, they can transmit back nice pictures to look around to see what the environment is like. If that's successful, then they'll contemplate sending off the rover off the pedal and move just a few meters away from the lander, and that would be a very successful first day if they can get that lander off, or the rover off the pedal.
For the time being, enormous technology, enormous effort that now rests on Mars in a bundle of balloons, and they're waiting for the sun to come up. Professor Grimal of University of Oklahoma, thanks for being with us. Stay with us. We're going to have
Thank
to take
you.
A break, but we'll be back in a moment.
Spacecraft has landed base pedal down. What are the odds? No speculation.
With the MCI calling card, you just pick up the phone and pick up the miles.
Hey, Bill, the meeting went great. I'll fax you the latest proposal. Hey, Marcel, I'll be in Paris tomorrow. Let's set up a presentation.
Use the MCI card from almost anywhere in the world with a world phone access number and earn miles on one of seven major airlines.
Hi, honey, I'm on my way home. How's Hawaii sound to you? We sure have the miles.
See USA Today for the world phone access number of the country you're calling from.
News and information are essential for today's travelers. Make certain you choose one of these fine CNN International Partner hotels next time you travel. For more information about these and other Pan Pacific hotels and resorts, turn to page 392 on CNN Text, where available.
NASA scientists have reason to cheer. The Mars Pathfinder has landed on the red planet. The entry, descent, and landing about half an hour ago went exactly according to plan. The U.S. spacecraft parachuted through the red planet's atmosphere and landed on an airbag cushion. NASA received signals from the spacecraft as it entered Mars's atmosphere and as it landed, but is not to receive any more communications from the Pathfinder for a few hours. Spacecraft is to release what's known as the Sojourner rover, that vehicle designed to creep along the terrain and send pictures and data back to Earth. Scientists have been nervously waiting this event, but one of the scientists who's been careful enough and kind enough to join us to talk about it is Kurt Grimal of the University of Oklahoma. Thanks for staying around to talk to us about
Thank you.
If you were watching before, we broke away to go to commercial and then went to a live picture from the Jet Propulsion Laboratory where scientists cheered for a new reason. They were told that the Pathfinder had landed on the base pedal. What is it that made them so happy about that?
Here is a model of the lander as it's currently resting on the surface of Mars. The only thing missing is the large airbags that have deflated and they're going to be pulled into the pedals. There is four different sides to this. This is called the base because if it opens up on the base, the other pedals will go off to the sides, and the base has the main equipment at the center.
So if they're rolling the dice, and this is a four-sided dice, they got the best possible roll,
I guess. Another option would be on one of the pedals, in which then it would have to correct itself which is a little more tricky to do. They certainly designed it for that, but by having it land on its base at the first time, it solves a lot of other problems.
Now, we're looking at this little model. It's a cute little thing. Give us a sense of the real scale of this. How big is the total package and the crucial rover on which so much rests? How big are they?
Well, to compare it to my hand here, this is a 1/10 model, so it would not be much bigger than the size of this table when it fully opens up. This rover itself is no bigger than a microwave oven. It's approximately a 0.5 meter long and 1/3 meter wide, and only maybe 20 centimeters high.
So this has been traveling through hundreds of thousands of kilometers of space, essentially to get something the size of a child's wagon to Mars, or
yes,
smaller.
But that's the nice, exciting thing about this, is every child in the world can relate to their own little remote-controlled toy that many of us have played with in our younger years. This is about the same size. And just like we would play with a remote-controlled toy, the NASA engineers now get to play with their $25 million remote-controlled toy.
Well, I want to ask you more about that. Are they literally, is there one lucky kid at NASA sitting with a joystick that's going to be telling us where to go?
There is three or four that will be operating the rover, but it's not quite like when we were young and we would push it forward and immediately would go forward. There is a 10-minute time delay, so that if we say go forward, in 10 minutes it'll go forward. If there's a cliff and we say stop, 10 minutes, it'll stop, hopefully not going over the cliff. Because of those problems, they have to have a lot of the intelligence built right into the rover. So it'll point to a direction and say, we want to go look at that rock. The rover has enough computer power and enough decision-making ability to be able to know the right path to get to that rock.
Now, as we're looking at this model, I don't know if anyone, well, we can see the picture. Those beautiful blue things, that's not just a colorful covering, is it? That's actually going to be an important part of the operation, the blue surfaces that we're seeing.
That's a solar panel, and one of the critical things about this mission is the power. They don't have enough, and they try to get as much power as they possibly can, so the whole top surface is a solar panel. That solar panel will help operate equipment on the rover. It'll also charge the batteries that are on the rover. Without that, they will not be able to have an extended mission. There is enough power in the batteries to go 7 days. But if they want to go beyond the 7 days, they're going to have to draw heavily upon these solar panels to recharge the batteries and to keep it going.
Right now, though, once again, it is a cold night on Mars that has welcomed the rover and the Pathfinder. Dr. Kirk Grimal, I hope you'll be with us some more in the hours to come. I am told you will, to explain all of this mission as it proceeds. For now, we thank you very much for your expertise.
Thank you.
Hillary?
Well, John, you know your kids are going to want a copy of this little rover. And it's not just a $25 million toy. It is, of course, the focus of Pathfinder's mission, and it is supposed to collect and chart data from the planet's surface. Well, it will be done from the Sojourner buggy, as we just said, and CNN's John Zarella is going to report on how that vehicle came about.
There have been big ones. There have been little ones. For years now, rovers of all sizes and shapes have run over rocks, cruised along desert landscapes. They've been tested and redesigned over and over again. Finally, this. Sojourner is what engineers and scientists chose to send to Mars. This is where much of its testing took place, the sandbox at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory in California. Sojourner, a six-wheeled, 23-pound solar-powered rover, is the centerpiece of NASA's Pathfinder mission.
This will be one of the first images we'll get down from Mars. This is obviously of our test bed, but what we want to look at is make sure that these airbags are underneath where the ramp would deploy here.
If the lander and Sojourner survive the airbag landing on Mars, Sojourner will begin its snail's pace crawl across the surface. Once it finds a rock scientists back on Earth find interesting, the rover's alpha proton X-ray spectrometer will spend up to 10 hours analyzing the composition.
The rover stops the last thing in the day, puts the spectrometer on the rock or on the ground, and it just collects data all night long. And then by the time the sun comes up the next morning, the rover's ready to go off and move again.
With the ability to analyze one rock a day, engineers and geologists hope the little vehicle just keeps on going and going. This is the Mars Yard. Scientists and engineers here have already forgotten about Pathfinder and are working on the next generation of Mars rovers. This is Rocky 7, the latest in mini rovers. It looks like Sojourner, but is far more autonomous.
as a rover in the future moves away from the lander, it needs to be able to look at the terrain all by itself and tell itself where to go.
Rocky 7, or something similar, will fly to Mars in 2001. It will gather rocks and wait there until 2005. That's when NASA plans to send a vehicle to pick up the samples and bring them back to Earth. John Zarella, CNN, Pasadena, California.
Mars back to planet Earth. That provided another reason for extreme excitement in that mission control room.
EDLCOM report signal detect on both subcarriers.
We have confirmed that the spacecraft is now completed pedal deployment, and we're transmitting our final semaphore on the low gain antenna. We now expect to get a signal in the spacecraft at 2:09 Pacific Daylight Time with real digital data. Stay tuned for more excitement from Mars Pathfinder.
Well, 2:09 Pacific Daylight Time is 6 minutes 26 seconds from right now. Out there at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, my colleague John Zarella standing by. John, what is this digital data going to tell people, do you think?
Well, John, the hope is that it will give them the status of all the systems and subsystems, the engineers here and all, that that the vehicle is healthy, that everything is working, and that then they can proceed on with the next steps of the mission. Everything has gone just absolutely beyond anything that the engineers could have expected here. And I'm getting a nod of agreement from Donna Shirley, who is, of course, the director of Mars Exploration for NASA. And Donna, you've got some toys that we've got here. The real thing is up there.
And yes, it is.
To give the folks out there an idea of where we stand right now on Mars. What is the situation?
Okay, the situation is, if we can focus in on this toy, this is the lander. Now, this doesn't have the airbags on it, so the real lander has these airbags sticking out. When we landed on Mars, we actually came in and landed and bounced and rolled and tumbled and came to rest on the bottom of the spacecraft, which
couldn't have been better.
Absolutely perfect. See, we could have, even if we'd landed on the side, still opened up to the bottom, but we didn't. We landed on the bottom. Then we got a signal that the airbags had been fully retracted. That is, the airbags had little strings inside them and a little fishing reel that reels them in and pulls them up tight, up against these, up against the pedals. In fact, here's a piece of airbag material. So you can picture it there. Then the pedals opened up like this, and we know that it's opened up, and we know that the rover is sitting on one of the pedals like that. And the next thing we're gonna hear is the data that says, okay, we made it down, here's everything that happened to us on the way down, and that all the subsystems and the rover are healthy.
All right, what we're going to do is throw it back to Atlanta, to John Holloman, and try and get, take a break here for a minute so that we can get back when all of this exciting information hopefully starts to flow back down down to Earth.
Good.
John, back to you.
All right, Donna Shirley, John Zarella, thank you both. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back, and perhaps when we come back, we'll know things about things going on Mars that we've never known before. Stay with us. Here's what's coming up. First pictures from Mars, 7:30, about 2.5 hours from now. First weather report at 9 o'clock Eastern Time. Color horizon picture, the big picture, coming up at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time. Quickly, back to the Jet Propulsion Lab, where John Zarella and Donna Shirley are waiting for the first data from Mars, which should begin arriving in 52 seconds. John,
you know, and one of the interesting things, too, about Mars, this first sunset may be blue instead of red. They said there's some possibility.
That's what Peter said.
Yeah, Donna Shirley is with us. And just to give our viewers an idea of just how small everything is, tell us what that is.
Okay, this is a stretched out radio. And this is a commercial radio modem built by Motorola that we have qualified to go to Mars. And when folded up, this thing is the size of a cigarette pack. And we have one of these on the rover. and we have one on the lander, and that's how the lander and the rover talk to each other. They're not actually connected at all.
And this is one of the ways you're able to do these missions faster, cheaper, better.
Right.
Everything has gotten so small and compact.
Right, and we're being able to take advantage of commercial technology is also very important.
So, John, you can see that we've got our little micro circuit here. We've got our rover, and now it looks as if all we've got to do is wait here for the signals to come back from Mars to let us know that all of these things are working and working properly. And then you can move on to the next step, correct?
Right, that's right.
And what will that be? Then what do you do?
The next step is that the lander camera is going to locate the sun, and then the high-gain antenna here will swing up and point to the Earth, and then we'll be able to send back a lot of data so that we can actually see pictures.
Mission control right now. I think we can hear what's going on there.
Can we?
Are they still waiting,
ready?
Donna? Can you tell?
Oh, here we go. Are they talking?
They're not saying much, Donna and John. I'm looking in on mission control while you were talking with our viewers.
Okay.
Everybody's pulling out their home movie camera and their home still camera. A lot of, it looks like high school reunion time, actually, in mission control.
Of course, it's a 10-minute delay, right, in time, and these things are not precise.
No, these are Earth-received times.
It is not precise.
I'm looking
That's
at a computer screen in mission control right now, and it looks like there are some streams of old data on it, and people are beginning to gather it at a couple of these screens, hoping that they're going to see some new data when it comes in. There's one man in there who is making a home movie of the computer screen, so when that first data begins to come down on the screen, he will have it for his grandchildren.
Okay, well, why don't I talk about what's going to happen?
This doesn't necessarily mean for the viewers out there that there's anything wrong because we're not hearing anything
Absolutely not. In fact, we don't know exactly when anything is going to happen. The 209 was the earliest time when we would expect the data back. And it could be that, because of conditions around the spacecraft. For example, if the spacecraft landed where there's a big hill next to it, we have to wait for the Earth to get up above that hill before we'd be able to hear it. So it might be as long as 30 minutes to an hour before we actually get it back. This was just if everything was nice and flat.
And then what happens?
Then it will send back a signal saying, okay, here's what happened to me on the way in. Here's all the bumps and lumps and the parachute being deployed, and all those events will be captured, plus all the health of the systems, including the health of the rover and the health of the lander electronics, because the rover will send its data, says, here's how healthy I am, to the lander. And then the lander, over this low-gain antenna, this little stalk here, is going to be sending that back to Earth at a low data rate. So this is our first downlink, and it really depends on when the Earth gets up above the horizon.
Now, I understand I was talking to some folks about the airbags, for example. You'll even be able to tell how far you bounced, how high you bounced.
Right.
That's amazing.
Yes. Well, there's accelerometers in here, and every time you bounce, there's a hit on the accelerometer. And so once we know how many bounces, and we know how far apart they were, and we know where we ended up, then we'll be able to tell how far we actually went.
Donna, do we know anything about the atmosphere on Mars? I mean, what it is made up of, and will we know more after this data comes back from Pathfinder?
Well, we know that the atmosphere is almost entirely carbon dioxide, and that it's approximately 1% as dense as the Earth's atmosphere. Viking told us all that very well, and we won't add to that. However, what we will add is what it was like coming in, because we only have two holes in the atmosphere that have ever been bored before, and that was by the two Viking landers. So this is a third hole that's being bored in the atmosphere. And we'll be able to compare the things that happened on the way down. Will tell us how thick the atmosphere was at different parts of it, and maybe which way the wind was blowing and what the temperatures were. We get a lot of information about the profile of the atmosphere as we came through it.
Go ahead, John. Excuse me.
I was just going to say, John, I think that information is really going to be critical, isn't it, to future missions?
Yes, it is. It's especially critical to our future landers, but it's also important for Mars Global Surveyor. Mars Global Surveyor is going to go into orbit in September. And instead of going right into the low mapping orbit, the low polar mapping orbit that we want to be in for our two-year mapping mission, our two-Earth-year mapping mission, we'll end up in a big, loose orbit.
That we have symbol sync and we're waiting to get frame sync. We expect that to happen in 5 to 7 minutes.
Frame sync in 5 to 7 minutes.
Which means we'll start to get digital data.
When we do frame sync, we'll have digital data. What that means is the data is coming into the deep space network, and it's kind of going beep, 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 beep in little bits.
So it is coming in now. Now
yeah,
they know it's coming in.
They know it's coming in, but they don't know what the content is.
Mm-hmm.
Then it has to synchronize up so that the data comes in little packets of information, and those packets have to be synchronized so that it reads the right time to start and the right time to finish, and that's called frame syncing. And so that has to happen before we can understand what the data tells us.
But that's another good sign, isn't it?
It's a good sign that the information,
they're getting it.
Yeah, the bits are starting evidently to come in, and it's just a matter of synchronizing the radio on the ground so that the information is being received properly.
Well, we've got some time now to wait, another 5 to 6 minutes, and we're going to take a break from here. It's a lot hotter here, isn't it, than
it is
on Mars.
Yes, it is.
It's certainly not like this there right now. It's probably a little chilly.
Mars, it's about 100 degrees below zero right now.
I'm not sure which is worse about this particular point in time. But, John, we're going to throw it back to you right now and take a break here at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory.
Zarella didn't point out that I'm here in the nice air-conditioned studio while he's out there in the hot sun with Donna Shirley. This packet frame synchronization is the same way that you get email messages, because I've looked into the program for the email on my computer. And so that's sort of what this thing is doing, trying to send some email to the Earth. We'll be back with more of our live coverage in just a moment. Stay with CNN. This is pretty exciting stuff. Planet behind me is becoming more and more clear to people on the ground. We're going to go back to the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, where, Donna Shirley, I'm told we have a frame of data. What does that mean, and what do you think it indicates, and what is it going to tell us, a frame of data?
Well, a frame of data is one piece of information that describes, in this case, the condition of the spacecraft. So this is really exciting. This is the data we've been waiting for. This is the mom I made it. You know, the safe arrival phone call.
Yep.
And this is what we've been hoping for.
Yeah, and I can see Dan Goldin, the administrator of NASA, Ed Stone, the head of the Jet Propulsion Lab there, with some of your scientists, your team leaders. I don't know if you can see them on TV or not, but they are looking at that computer screen with great interest. And I know Dr. Stone is a man who has a lot of experience with computers, and Mr. Golden's a man who used to design spy satellites. So this kind of a day for the two of them, with all of their knowledge from their backgrounds, must be scintillating and exciting. And nobody's frowning. That's a good sign, I think.
That's a good sign. I haven't heard a lot of screaming yet, though, so that's my indicator, since I'm out here on the mall instead of being
in
the control
room. Well, one frame is not much, right?
One frame's not much, but if we got one frame, we got a bunch of frames.
How many frames are going to take before you have a good feel? I mean,
you would ask me that,
wouldn't
you?
I would ask you that.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
I don't know the answer to that.
A lot of frames.
Yeah, a lot of frames. Well, a frame is, John just described it beautifully a while ago. It's like email. And when you send email, it goes in chunks, you know, like it'll show up, like when you're printing a picture out from the internet or some data out from the internet, you know, you get a piece of it, and then you get another piece of it, another piece that shows up on your screen. Well, this is that same kind of thing. And it has to be synchronized so that the receiver and the sender are going along at the same frequency. And
you know,
that's what syncing is.
I was just asking you a very non-technical question.
And I made it technical.
No, not that question. A question before. Would you have ever imagined the level of attention that this mission has got?
Well, actually, yes. I was the one that predicted 4 years ago that we would have this kind of attention, and nobody believed me. So I'm happy to be vindicated in this case. Now, what I just hope is that everything keeps going as well as it has gone in the past. So I'm waiting for the rest of those frames to come in.
Go ahead, John.
Let's go back into the control room. Tell us who the people are in that picture. I see Ed Stone in the middle, the JPL director. You're a ship controller.
You know, I can't.
There's
a glare on our screen.
Hard for us to see who exactly is in there. It looks like Jennifer Harris there is the one of the.
It could be.
Jennifer Harris on the left, one of the flight controllers.
Okay.
Yeah.
Brilliant red hair.
Okay. Yeah. That's Richard Cook on the far right. Brian Muirhead with the bald
Muirhead.
Head next to us. Ed
we
Stone.
Have the yeah.
All right. They got it. Woo!
Another great moment.
Another great moment. All right. There are so many great moments here.
Donna,
I don't know what they got, but they got
it. They got something.
Donna, don't have a heart attack.
I'm not having a heart attack. I'm happy.
There are cheers all around. Maybe we can listen in to the mission control and see what it is they've got.
Good plan.
Yeah, no chills.
How's the data looking?
Oh, broadcast 6 minutes.
Yeah, the computer screen's in Mission Control are filling up with data. I can see it on the wide picture we have of Mission Control right now.
Play software.
Go ahead.
Preliminary, no EVR warnings as of the first packet down.
Okay, keep in mind that packet time was 2052, just before S12 started.
That means everything's okay.
John, you might have heard just now that was Donna saying that no warnings means that everything is okay in the first packet of information.
That's right.
And a packet of information is...
is some amount of bits that makes some numbers that tell us the condition of the spacecraft.
Of certain systems.
Any particular systems
that were coming first, the information first,
I have no idea? I have no idea what order.
Do we have commitment on it this time?
Yes, we do. Thank you.
Donna, that's real good news. Now, this... the computer inside the Pathfinder is designed to send you warnings if it detects anything wrong. It's kind of like your home computer. If you lost a program or something, a little message will come up, and that's sort of what these packets of information are. Am I right?
So everything's pretty clean right now. Now the content, the controllers actually have to look at the data for a while to see if everything's within limits. Now they do have alarms that are set up, so if something's out of limits, it would say, whoops, I'm too hot, or I'm too cold, or I've been stressed too much. And so far, I don't think we have any of that.
It's kind of like when you get a big
this
a blood
workup. This is Mission Control, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory.
Can you give us an update as to when we expect to see DPT-9 active, which means we get data other than
I believe we're going to get three more EH&A packets before we open up DPT-9, which then would start allowing EDL
Mission Control, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory.
Obvious exuberance in the flight control team when the data started to come in. Not only data, but they were not only the carrier signal, but they were actually receiving data. Now the team is back to business as they start to analyze that data, interpret exactly what the state of the lander is. Jennifer Harris, the flight director in the center, and Richard Cook to
they'll,
the right.
They'll be telling you what the data is at the press conference, which I think is coming up at 2:30.
Right now, we have to determine what the data is to look at the numbers on the screen, interpret those numbers,
understand which
there's going to be a project statement coming up
right
in just a few minutes from Brian Muirhead, Deputy Project Manager and Flight System Manager. This is Mars Pathfinder Mission Control.
Here comes Brian, as a matter of fact, with Dan Goldin and Ed Stone. So
I wonder if we can get Dan Goldin to come over here for a...
Well, Brian's more important.
Brian and
both,
Dan Goldin. We've got to try and get them both over on CNN very quickly.
I'll talk while you
get,
go grab them.
The administrator. We're on live right now, Mr. Administrator. 2 seconds with John Holloman. You got 2 seconds? Just 2 seconds. Very quickly. John Zarella, Donna Shirley, and John Holloman in Atlanta. This has got to be a tremendously...
Well, I'll get out of the kiss.
Grab this and talk to John. John, you have a question for the administrator, and maybe Mr. Administrator, a comment.
His reaction when those first frames of information came in.
Your reaction.
Oh, this is wonderful. I was just over in the control room, and we had a grand total of 15 people, John, that were operating this spacecraft, and in the past, we had hundreds. And it landed, and when that digital signal came through, the sky opened up, and it was nice and clear, and the sun was shining.
And you proved that cheaper, faster, better works.
Well, we're not there yet. I want to be very level throughout this, and I also have to leave because I have to speak to the Vice President.
Thanks, Dan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Goldin. Appreciate it. Well, that was good. I'll throw my mic back on here now, John.
A little target of opportunity.
Yeah, target of opportunity. We never seize an opportunity at
CNN.
That's
right,
Anyway, John, so he's on his way over. So that news conference ought to be starting in about 4 or 5 minutes?
Yeah,
Donna,
looks like it.
They should have some indication then of what the data is.
Right, right.
And how good it is.
Yes, I think it's going to be good. But I hope they've had time to at least look at it a little bit because Brian left up there while they were still looking at the numbers.
Well, that must be a good sign, too. He doesn't seem like he's... That's the deputy project manager, right?
Right, the deputy project manager.
He seems to be pretty comfortable with what's going on.
Yeah. I think we're okay. I mean, at least so far it looks like we're okay.
How long will it take them? How much data will come in? How long will this downlink of data be going on?
Well, this downlink of data goes on now. They'll be downlinking data the rest of the day until Earth sets. And Earth sets, I think, around... 8:30 or 9 at night tonight, something like that. And so we'll be getting a continuous stream of data. The next thing we're going to do is to see if the high gain antenna is pointed in the right direction, and then we can start to get back data at about 2,500 bits per second.
You can do this simultaneously then. You'll be getting low gain data right all constantly.
Well, no, I think we get this. We stop doing low gain, and if we can get it onto the high gain, then we send it over the high gain. Now, the data that comes in from the low gain is about 250 bits per second. And if you have a really kind of funky modem on your computer, it's at least 9,600 bits per second. So the low gain is very slow. But even the high gain is only 2,500 bits per second. So it's only about a quarter as fast as a really bad, not too good modem.
So one I'm working with in the computer,
right.
Back in the trailer right now, it's exactly what I'm working, 9,600.
So it takes a long time to downlink a picture. As you know, when you try to downlink something from the internet, how long that takes. And so it takes even longer from Mars. And then we send them over to the image processing lab. And I was just talking to Bill Green, who is our image processing laboratory leader. And he said it'll only take them a few minutes to process the pictures once they get them back. And Peter Smith, the principal investigator for the camera, will be standing right there looking at the screen. And if the calibration is right and the colors look right and it looks like it's a good picture, then they'll send it right out and it'll be in the press conference, which is maybe they'll be, not the first picture, the first picture will be there at about 4:30.
But the world will see the pictures very quickly
after
you see them.
That's right. We put them right out on NASA Select. You guys can put them out to the world. That's why you're here.
We certainly will.
And they'll also go on the internet.
All right. Well, John, we're going to go back to you now so that we can get ready for that news conference in just a couple minutes. John?
Ask some good questions, old friend. All right, we got a few times to tell you about. 2 hours from now, first picture. Maybe a little bit sooner, we don't know yet. 9 o'clock Eastern time, first weather report. 9:30 p.m., first color wide-angle picture of the horizon on Mars. And what we have been seeing just time after time after time, we saw just a few minutes ago as the first positive data came back from the Mars Pathfinder saying that everything on board was okay. Let's listen and look at the reaction there in the Mars Pathfinder Mission Control Room one more time.
We have EHNA!
All right. That's it for our coverage for right now. Our journey to the Red Planet, a lot more to do tonight. We'll take a quick break. We'll see you very shortly. John Holliman, CNN reporting.
The following is CNN's coverage of a live event.
What a 4th of July they're having at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory and all around the United States, where people who are interested in the exploration of the solar system around Earth's sun are seeing the first live data being beamed back from the surface of planet Mars that's happened in about 20 years. A news conference is about to start at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. Dan Goldin, the administrator of NASA, just stopped by CNN's John Zarella's live position to let us know that the Vice President of the United States is out in California. Mr. Goldin and the Vice President, as you'll probably remember, were live with us here on CNN yesterday afternoon at about this time. They'll be holding this news conference along with the mission and planetary scientists at the Jet Propulsion Lab, who have just gotten word that the Pathfinder space probe has every system that has been checked and has had information beamed back to the Earth is working just fine. John Zarella, before this news conference gets underway, you have been assimilating information for a long, long time today, yesterday, and in the previous days. There's nothing really going wrong here, is there?
No, and that's certainly a surprise to everyone. They had contingency plans lined out that if this went wrong, they would do this. They'd move to this contingency plan. And so far, none of that has happened. It has gone swimmingly, much better than, as well as anyone could have hoped. And the hope now, of course, is that it continues to move along in that direction, going as well as it has. In the course of events, something could go haywire at this point and from this point on. But so far, that's not the case. And, you know, I guess, Don, one of the things, we can't call this a spacecraft anymore, can we? It's a lander.
It's a lander.
I mean, it's on the ground. It's
on
not
the
a
ground.
Spacecraft.
Yeah, it's a lander and a rover. It's two spacecraft now.
It's two spacecraft.
It's thrown away some of its previous incarnations as a spacecraft, and now it's a lander.
All of those work
perfectly. Nothing went wrong that you know of at this point. And now you move on to getting the lander, or to getting Sojourner off.
Right. Well, the first thing we want to get back is we want to get the camera to look around and take a picture. And what the camera will do, it'll point at the rover's pedals and then point around to see if any of the airbags have lopped over onto the pedals. Now, here's some airbag material. What we don't want is for it to look like that. We want all these airbags to be neatly tucked underneath. And once the airbags are tucked underneath, and especially around the rover pedal, then we know it'll be okay to stand the rover up, to deploy the meteorology mast, which is over on this pedal, and then to unroll the ramps. And then the high gain antenna will be sending back some data. And if we get a good picture, then we'll know it's safe to send the rover
up. And these are solar panels, which is another reason why you don't want any of this material over the top of it, right?
That's right. All the power comes out of these
pedals. Out of these pedals. That's the solar panels.
And we need to get the rover off because you can see the rover's sitting on top of some solar arrays.
Some of the solar
arrays. So it's actually blocking the solar energy. So not only do we want to get the rover off so she can go to work, but we want to get her off so she's not blocking the solar arrays.
Hey, Donna, John Holloman, yes. Just jumping in for a minute. If everything goes just the way you want to, how many different pictures of Mars will we have? I can't finish the question. The news conference is underway. We're going to go there. I'll ask you when we get done.
Telemetry from the spacecraft. This is way beyond our expectations. The whole day has just been extraordinary. I don't think any of us expected today to go like it has. Every time we looked for the spacecraft, it was there. It gave us clear indications it was on the surface, it was healthy within 3 minutes after landing. And now, just now, we've received our first telemetry from the spacecraft. We're getting down the health of the spacecraft, and it sounds like everything is absolutely perfect. So we hope to be able to continue the day with images coming up soon, and then maybe even the rover. So I can't be any more excited than I am, and I know the whole team feels the same way. I suspect you guys share in this with us as well. Thank you very much for your support.
Mr. Goldin?
What a birthday today. There's a lot of fireworks in the mission control room where I had the privilege of talking to some of the people who did this. And it's interesting. This is a revolution just of the type of the revolution that formed our country on the day of our birthday. The people who formed our country weren't afraid of taking risk. They weren't afraid of doing things differently, just like the Mars Pathfinder team. And they're doing just a terrific job. And you could sense the pride among each of them as they hugged each other. There's a tremendous warmth. It's just not respect, but it's a warmth. And I think this is going to change the history of the space program. Congratulations, Brian. And to you, Tony Spear, who's listening right now.
Dr. Stone?
So, what a way to celebrate the 4th of July. Doing what no one has done before. That's what NASA's all about. That's what JPL's all about. And I think today, the Pathfinder did what no one has done before. And of course, they have a number of days ahead now of doing things that nobody has done before because nobody could do them before. So it's, again, congratulations to the team that made it all happen. It really has kicked off a new era of Mars exploration, which is going to be a very exciting period for everyone.
Now we'll start with Q&As. Seth? We have a microphone. Just go.
Seth Borenstein, Orlando Sentinel. Do you know where on Mars you are, how close you are to good rocks or stuff yet?
No, we don't. And we won't know that until we see our first images down as far as what the terrain looks like. But we know we're down. We know we're very healthy.
Do you think you're in that last circle from before?
Well within that. And we won't know until we've spent some more time with the ranging.
You can go next.
The phone is ringing here.
I think we might have a phone call.
Hello?
You guys just stand by?
Could be ET.
Hang on, if y'all stand by for a minute.
I'll hang up, they'll call back.
Problem?
Do you guys want subscription to late month?
The phone call is going to come from the Vice President of the United States.
Hello, Mr. Vice President.
We'll listen.
Hey, Dan. Congratulations to all of you out there on behalf of President Clinton and all of the people of our country. Happy 4th of July, and congratulations on doing an absolutely outstanding job.
Well, I tell you, I'm here with the Deputy Project Manager, Ned Stone, the Director of the Jet Propulsion Lab, and I can't begin to tell you what a wonderful job these people have done for our country.
Well, congratulations, Dr. Stone and Brian Muirhead, and to all of the members of the team who've been a part of this magnificent accomplishment. The whole country is just very proud of what you all are doing and have done today, and what a great way to celebrate America's birthday and celebrate our country's know-how and ingenuity as we press forward to new heights and new frontiers. I'm very excited about this. I've been following this throughout the day and watched the cheering there when the signals came in when you were going down through the atmosphere. And like everybody else, I'm looking forward to seeing the images when they come through. And I know that not too long after you get the first images, you're going to be deploying the rover. And I had a chance, Dan, when you and I were out there when I made the announcement on the new X-33 on behalf of the president, we got to see that model that backup firsthand and how it works. And it's just amazing that so much technology has been able to you've been able to put so much technology into such a small vehicle. It's really just a very exciting and historic moment, and I do want to congratulate all of you. And Dan, to all of NASA, this new way of doing business, faster, better, cheaper, is certainly being borne out by this dramatic success today. And keep up the good work. The President and I are both very, very proud of your accomplishments, and the entire country is just reveling in your success, and we all congratulate you.
Mr. Vice President, we couldn't have done it without the tremendous support you and the President have given us. You've been there at every step. You knew it was risky, but you trusted us, and we wanted to come through for you.
Well, you sure did, and I'll be watching very carefully, along with the many millions of others, as the images begin to come through and as we follow the adventures of this vehicle going out onto the Martian soil. So we're all going to be watching carefully. Good luck, and congratulations again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
We have some more data coming back, I understand, so I think Brian probably has to leave, and we'll be back again at 3:30 for a more formal, extensive press conference. Thank you.
So, the more formal, extensive press conference without the staged phone call from the Vice President will be coming up in, just a couple of hours from now. And when it happens, we will be back with more live coverage, and there are some other things going on in the world we want to tell you about, too. That will be coming up as well. Stay with CNN.